As we should, we are going to begin college football final with the best finish on Saturday. Texas State, Boston College, fourth quarter, BC down 21-14. Phil Jurkovec, Hunter Long, touchdown, game tied at 21. So after a Texas State three and out, BC with the ball just across midfield, 29 seconds left, Jurkovec finds Zay Flowers, first down, BC in field goal range. Aaron Boomer getting ready to kick the game winner. 7 seconds left. We do not have a college kicker scenario. Ball game, and Boston College wins 24-21. And with that, welcome into college football final. Jesse Palmer, Joey Galloway, Matt Berry. This was a big week in college football. Number one, we welcome back the Pac-12. We welcome back the Mountain West. The MAC decided they want to play ball again. And gentlemen, most importantly, we welcomed back the SEC. And when you do that, you're talking about the defending national champions who didn't get the easiest matchup against Mississippi State. Miles Brennan, as you know, taking over for Joe Burrow, appeared in 10 games last season, but you're replacing perhaps one of the best offenses in college football history. Second quarter, third and goal, Brennan dropping back. I don't know that this is how he drew it up. End result, touchdown.
Brennan got hit a lot early in this game, was a little bit shaky, but here he finds his true freshman tight end, Eric Gilbert, 6'6", 250 pounds, Gatorade male athlete of the year in high school. I don't know if that was intended for him, but hey, Coach O, LSU, they'll take it.
And Mike Leach coming from the Pac-12, brought some Pac-12 with him. Stanford grad transfer KJ Costello, 3rd and 10. Costello to Osiris Mitchell, 43 yards and a touchdown.
Mississippi State had three receivers with more than 120 yards receiving in this game. This offense is going to be fun to watch.
The Leach effect, full effect, 36 pass attempts in the first half, tied for the most by an SEC quarterback in the first half in the last 15 sevens. Bulldogs up. Fourth quarter, Brennan to Terrence Marshall Jr.
And Brennan really settled down here in the second half. Terrence Marshall Jr., now the go-to guy in this LSU attack, now that, of course, Jamar Chase has opted out.
So after an LSU score to make it 34-31, State has it from their own 25-yard line. Costello in the gun, sees the pressure coming around the edge from the defensive end. So LSU has a spy on Costello. The QB avoids the pressure, steps right into Jacoby Stevens, who gets the strip sack. Not much defense out of LSU on the day. That big Mississippi State would get another chance to put the game away after the strip sack. A little over 5 minutes to go. 2nd and 10. Costello, Mitchell across the middle, 27 yards.
Mitchell, 7 catches, 183, 2 touchdowns in this game. And give Costello credit. Makes the mistake, but gets back up and brings his team back.
Under 4 minutes to go, Jesse. How big was this?
This was huge. LSU played a lot of bump and run press coverage, and Costello threw it 60 times. No Derek Stingley Jr., their best corner, out because of an illness. And how good was Costello on third down, guys? 7 for 11, 3 touchdowns, 623 passing yards for the Stanford QB.
LSU, the first defending national champion to lose the opener since 98. Here's Leach.
It's better than average, I'll tell you that. This stadium, there's a lot of ghosts in this stadium. And, you know, and you play, we played LSU because, you know, New England, Green Bay, and the Chiefs had somebody scheduled. So we played these guys. But I'm really proud of our guys. I thought we played real well. I thought we stuck in there during tough times and won the game. The best thing he did after we hit adversity, he responded to it. He does a great job being the same guy every play and can play the next play maybe as good as anybody I've dealt with.
All right, more statistical superlatives. One game into the Mike Leach era in the SEC, and it already looks different. Costello shattered the SEC single-game passing record, 623 passing yards, 79 yards more than the previous record, Eric Lightmizer. Costello had never thrown for 400 yards in his career at Stanford. That says more about Stanford's offense than it does Costello. Here's Ed Ogeron following the loss.
Boom, put it on me. When they win, I give them the credit. When they don't, I got to take the blame. I got to get them better. I got to coach better. I ask everybody to look at themselves in the mirror, see what we're doing. Let's get better. Let's stick together as a football team. We got a lot of football left. I still believe we have a good football team. We have a lot of young guys that played for the first time. They got their taste of SEC play. Anytime you play in the SEC, there's going to be great athletes across the ball. You got to win your one-on-ones. We didn't do that tonight.
All right, so that's one top seven upset on Saturday. This, a top three game, Kansas State, Oklahoma, OU looking for revenge from K-State a year ago, and Spencer Rattler picked up where he left off. Marvin Mims back at the end zone.
Rattler looked good early, started this game 13 of 15, but those two incompletions were interceptions.
First play of the second quarter, after a quick 7-0 lead, Rattler to Drake Stoops, son of one Bob Stoops.
That name sounds familiar. How about Stoops here coming back for the football, boxing out the defender? I think Dad's liking it from the press box.
Press box getting a smile then. 14-7, first and goal at the 9. Rattler rips one over the middle to Men.
Oklahoma had almost 200 more yards total offense and 13 more first downs in the first half.
I mean, this was a blowout. We're going to get snacks, thinking OU's going to roll. Wildcats wouldn't go away quietly. 35-14, here comes Skylar Thompson.
Very tough running, especially down by the goal line. 4 total touchdowns for Thompson, 3 on the ground.
Now Oklahoma making mistakes. Seth McGowan here gets crushed. Fumbles the ball, K-State recovers, takes over at the 38, ensuing possession, Thompson again.
Thompson rushed for 3 touchdowns in this game, and the only chance that K-State has to come back and maybe take a lead is if Oklahoma continues to make mistakes, and here we go.
Oh, and then you get a special team. Did this go in this way? You've got turnovers, you got special teams. Jesse, everything's lining up.
Yeah, and you listen, you're playing on the road, right, in Norman. You need something to happen. You need a momentum shifter, and this was the play.
How about Deuce Vaughn? 28-yarder. Boy, he's just a little starter kid, isn't he?
Yeah, and Deuce also added 4 catches for 129 yards in this game.
All tied at 35, so Thompson checks it down to Vaughn. Stopped well short of the first down. This is 3rd and 13, Oklahoma 41. So Wildcats would have to settle for a field goal attempt. And Jesse, the kickers showed up huge on Saturday.
They really did. How about this right here? 50-yard attempt. Lynch nails the kick down the middle. After scoring 24 unanswered points, K-State takes their first lead of the game.
So for a day, we're going to retire the hashtag college kickers because they were big. After being down 21, Kansas State gets their first road win against a top three team in school history. 38-35 the final, and Chris Klieman loved it with his team afterwards.
What did I tell you guys at halftime? One play at a time.
Not better than us.
And they were not better than us. We were beating ourselves. And I told you to stay the damn fight. And you stood the fight, and you kept battling. Guys, when you play for each other, great things can happen.
You lose to Arkansas State, but then you beat Oklahoma. Lincoln Riley has had plenty of success at OU, but has been tripped up by Kansas State both times since Chris Klieman took over. No sooner can air it out, but the Wildcats have held them to 116 yards per game on the ground in the last two meetings. Sooners have averaged 236 per game against all others under Riley. Let's hear from the Sooners.
The story of the game is what it is. I mean, it's, you know, you got a team that, you know, dominated plays, yards, time of possession, third downs, all of that. But again, it comes down to turnovers, and it comes down to some busted assignments. So, I mean, our front did some good things, but do we expect more of them? And for them to continue to get better, absolutely.
There was so much good football on Saturday. We're going to break a little protocol here and give out some early helmet stickers to make sure everyone's taken care of. And, Jesse, I want to start with you.
Kansas State quarterback Skylar Thompson, guys. Gritty performance. He got hurt in their loss against Arkansas State. Missed a lot of practice time for this game. All the dude did is come out, throw for 334 yards, 4 total touchdowns. All this guy does is beat the Sooners. Skylar Thompson, awesome.
And the upset of OU a year ago, 4 rushing touchdowns for Thompson. Who are you going to give an early sticker to?
I got KJ Costello, 623 yards passing.
How many?
60 times.
Wow.
5 touchdowns. Mike Leach gets his first win in the SEC.
Mm. Isn't that amazing? KJ Costello didn't do anything near that at Stanford, and all of a sudden now missed
it. Bit of a different offense.
Mike Leach, a little trendy pick to click. But as we talk about the games we just discussed, some upsets early on in the season, most notably Oklahoma, who we thought was Spencer Rattler after they debuted the class of the Big 12. We didn't see it.
Same old OU, right? Same old Sooners. They score on everybody, but the defense continues to be their Achilles heel. And that's what's kept them out of the national championship game in the college football playoff era. Just way too many explosive plays against Kansas State. It starts with really bad tackling. Here's a running back running an option route. You've got this player surrounded with three defenders. You can't get him on the ground. Safety takes a bad angle, and it ends up being an explosive play. We saw coverage busts, guys running wide open. Defenders also taking bad angles. Here's a power run to the left side of the formation. You've got two defenders with an opportunity against one blocker. Here's a defender with a good angle. He can turn this ball back inside. He can make the tackle. He misses, and it's another explosive play. And then just backs coming out of the backfield and just splitting this offense right down the middle again. If you're right here, you've got this player surrounded. Six different players are going to get an opportunity to get this guy down, and Oklahoma cannot get it done. Just simply not good enough. They gave up 8 yards of play to the Wildcats, and no disrespect to Chris Klieman and his offense, this is not going to be one of the most explosive offenses in the Big 12 this year. So maybe, just maybe, again, Oklahoma for a sixth straight year can win just outscoring everybody. But, guys, they are not going to win a national championship with this defense. They just have to get better.
This has been their bugaboo, to be fair. They've got a lot of young players on the offensive side of the ball. And if we're being fair with LSU in their game against Mississippi State, 19 of the 22 players that were on the field of the national championship are either in the NFL or have opted out. But LSU did not bring their best ball to the yard against Mississippi State.
No, and we knew they lost players, and they lost their defensive coordinator in Aranda, went to Baylor. They lost Joe Brady, the pass game coordinator. So we knew this would look like a different ball club when they came out this season. But when you watch them, Miles Brennan had some ups and downs, and we expected that. He only threw 40 passes last season. Comes into this game, he goes 27 to 46. He's in the pocket. You see him looking to the right. He has space. He has time. There are guys open. Has to be comfortable enough to get the ball out of his hands. Waits till the pressure gets in his face. Throws the ball away. There are three guys rushing. We saw LSU light teams up last season. There's plenty of time again. Step up in the pocket, young man. He's looking to the right. Has time to go up the middle. And so you look once again, because he's not comfortable, he takes a sack in the situation. And then once again, in the pocket, it's a soft zone. They're dropping back. Mississippi State is just trying to keep everything in front of them. You got to complete this ball. Offensively, LSU didn't look like what we've seen in the past. The scariest part, really, wasn't Miles Brennan, who we expect to have some up and down. They ran the ball for 80 yards. And so if you're new offensive coordinator and you're taking over this offense, you know Miles Brennan hasn't played a lot of football. You have to find a way to help this young man out. The best way to help a quarterback, run the football. You're not going to win many SEC football games running the ball for 80 yards. That offense last season ran the ball well. If they're going to have success this season, they better find a way to run the ball.
And to be fair to Miles Brennan, he's taken over one of the best offenses in college football history. LSU's loss snaps their 16-game winning streak. Perhaps the most offensive game on Saturday. Where else would it be? The Big 12, Texas and Texas Tech. Texas 83-1 when leading by 10-plus points at the half since 2004. Lone loss, 2017 against who? Texas Tech. Alan Bowman and T.J. Vasher, 29-yarder.
Vasher looks like he's 7'2". He's 6'6", but athletic enough to carve up the defense and get in, and once again, Texas in a shootout.
Red Raiders cut the lead to 3. Now Sam Ellinger picked off by Alex Hogan.
And this is 3rd and 7, and this is Ellinger's first interception of the season, and boy, that came at a costly time.
And it sure did, because they take advantage. Roderick Thompson, 10-yard touchdown. Texas Tech takes the lead 42-38. 6:20 left in the fourth quarter. Texas Tech up 1. Bowman, Vasher, Diver.
Take advantage of the 6'6 receiver. Vasher, 4 catches, 74 yards, 2 touchdowns, and it took all 6'6 of him in that huge catch radius to bring this touchdown in and give Texas Tech the lead.
3:28 in the fourth. Texas Tech's own 25. Thompson bounces off the Texas defense. 75.
All right, all right. Look, this Texas defense now coached by Chris Ash, they looked so much better against UTEP a few weeks ago, but the tackling issues that we've seen in recent years, they show themselves again. And right now, 99.9% chance for Texas Tech to win this game.
By my math, that's just about 100%. So under 3 minutes to play, Texas still trails. Ellinger, Brennan Eagles, 12-yard touchdown
plenty
pass.
Plenty of time.
Here
all
comes,
you need is 2 points. Maybe
here comes
onside
Bevo.
Kick.
Let's get Cameron Dickers onside. Oh, wait. Oh, they got it. Okay. So 2:39 left. Texas has life. Bevo's breathing. 48 seconds left. Ellinger, 18-yarder. Josh Moore, touchdown.
Ellinger showing you the poison experience on the road. And Joshua Moore has now become the go-to guy for Sam Ellinger.
So we need the two-point conversion to force overtime. And look at Ellinger to Eagles. Two-point conversion. Ties it at 56. In overtime, Ellinger, 12-yard pass, touchdown.
Come on, Texas Tech. You got to make it a little harder than that to get in the end zone. Ellinger, 5 touchdown passes in this game.
Largest comeback win since 2007. What a finish. Here's Tom Herman.
Our quarterback actually looked at me and he said, they left us too much time. He said, we're going to tie this thing up and win it in overtime. And I believed him. If Sam Ellinger was trying to sell me oceanfront property in Arizona, I'd probably write him a check. He's usually right on.
He just quoted George Strait song? Sure did. So with just over 3 minutes left in the game and trailing by 15 points, Texas had a 0.1% chance to win. Win probability now 100% for Texas. Longhorns had lost their previous 39 games and trailing by 15 at any point, the most recent win in those circumstances back in 2007. So many helmet stickers to give out. These two gentlemen gave out a bonus sticker. I will do the same. Josh Moore, you heard Jesse say during the highlight, becoming the go-to guy. Joshua Moore, 5 receptions, 73 yards, 3 touchdowns. First Texas player with 3 receiving touchdowns in a game since Jackson Shipley. 2012. Oh. So early helmet stickers in the A block. We want to come out in the first quarter and have some fun. We'll still give out the standard helmet stickers coming up at the end. Oh, in case you didn't hear, the SEC was back and there was action all over the yard on Saturday. And remember when FSU Miami was good? Well, now it's only good for one team, and they are the alpha dog of South Florida. We're off and running. This is College Football Final.
College Football Final is brought to you by Gatorade. For athletes who make the days count, nothing beats Gatorade.
Matt, Jesse, and Joey back with you. Alabama came into their game against Missouri. 91 consecutive wins against unranked opponents. Mac Jones has just enough coming back to make them good again. Jalen Waddle.
Yeah, Mac Jones has been given the keys to a Ferrari. He's get the throw to Devontae Smith. And how about Jalen Waddle elevating, hanging on, taking the hits? This is going to be one of the most explosive offenses in the country.
Henry Ruggs gone, Jerry Jeudy gone, but Waddle is not.
And Waddle had 8 catches, 134 yards, and 2 touchdowns in this game. And Alabama looks like the Alabama we expected.
Yeah, same as it ever was, Jess. Again, Jones to Waddle.
Yeah, they look good throwing it and running it. Defense looked great in the first 3 quarters as well. Total team effort and their 92nd straight win against an unranked opponent.
Let's see if Saban's happy about it.
You know, Mac was really good tonight. He managed the offense really well. He made lots of really good decisions. So, you know, we just want to build on that and hopefully we can as an offensive unit.
Georgia and Arkansas before the game. Arkansas and Georgia locked arms and walked across the field together, promoting their unity in their communities and across the country. It is Sam Pittman's first season, first game as the Arkansas head coach. And I'll tell you this, if you learn one thing Saturday about them Dogs, they have quarterback issues. This gets embedded to George Pickens.
Now, Georgia's ranked number 4, favorite team in the SEC East. Arkansas hadn't won a game in the SEC in forever. Of course, this is going to be a blowout.
They came in 19 consecutive losses, Joey, in the SEC. Florida transfer Felipe Franks to Eric Stokes.
Well, they struggled offensively, but the defense bailed them out. 3 takeaways for the Dogs, and that was the difference in this game.
Pick 6 for Stokes. Georgia wins 37-10. Maybe the story of the day in the SEC, aside from LSU, Mississippi State, the other half of the state of Mississippi, Ole Miss Lane Kiffin making his debut against Kyle Trask and the Gators. 6 minutes into the game, it was clear he was up to the Trask.
Yeah, and had no idea they're going to have this kind of game. We've seen Trask really good in the past. Not sure we've seen him this good with connecting with Pitts.
Yeah, Kyle Pitts was dominant. Then Matt Corral launches it up to the Ontario Drummond. Rebels were in
there. Yeah, I got to tell you, Lane Kiffin's offense was fun to watch. There was 2 quarterbacks on the field at the same time. A lot of trick plays, double moves. They were being aggressive.
But let's just say it again. Trask to Pitts became the theme.
Yeah, you could have just showed these plays the entire highlight. Watch the big tight end turn his shoulders, get down low, double covered,
didn't matter.
This was frightening. Start of the third quarter, same score, Trask, plenty of time, and again, a perfect throw, 71 yards.
He's a guy that you can line up all over the field. Look at the straight arm. He's a preseason All-American for a reason. 642 yards of offense for Kyle Trask, Dan Mullen, and the Gators.
642 yards of that offense, that is a school record against an SEC opponent. 416 yards, 6 TDs. Ball coach would love it. Let's hear what Lane Kiffin and Dan Mullen had to say about Saturday.
He did a good job of, you know, of managing the whole offense, managing the game, getting us into the right place. You know, all the adjustments we made on the sideline, he did a great job getting to those adjustments and, you know, and creating and finding the mismatches all over the field. I think we did a really good job of that all day.
You know, that was a tough one. I mean, that's about as, you know, bad as you can play in against the pass, obviously. You know, 30 of 42, 416, 6 touchdowns, no picks. So those are video game stats.
They sure were. Fun to watch, though. What about Kentucky and Auburn? A lot of people thought maybe Kentucky could pull off the upset against Gus Malzahn, honoring the late, great Pat Dye with a recreation of that iconic outfit after Dye passed in June. Crazy sequence here. 47 seconds left in the first half. Christopher Rodriguez Jr. takes the direct snap, bulldozes his way towards the end zone. It appears he is in, but no signal from the officials.
Why?
Well, they officially finally rule Rodriguez short, and the play would be reviewed. What do you think?
Short of what?
Well,
that got to be a touchdown.
Okay.
Matthew.
All right. Well, there's the telestration. Pretty clear that the ball was over the goal line. I agree with you. So the referees ruled that it stopped his forward progress. Mark Stoops like, what do you mean? Two plays later, Terry Wilson's pass picked off by Roger McCreary. Now, he's got a clear path to the end zone, Jess.
Yeah, he does. It's a bad throw by Wilson, dropping back, leaning back, floating away, floats it over the middle of the field. McCreary's just going to take it 100 yards to the score.
Momentum.
The refs would review this one, although, and they take a look again, they would penalize Derek Hall for targeting on this block right here. Wipe
that.
The touchdown.
I
off
don't
the goal.
Know about. Look at Gus. Here he was during the halftime break of what he thought.
Well, we're up 8-7. They were about to score. We made a game-changing play. It was a touchdown. They called it back. So I hope like crazy that's a common sense call.
What do you guys think? Agree or disagree?
I think it's the right call.
Oh, dissension on the set. I love it. We can agree on this. Seth Williams is good.
Yeah, Bo Nix is good when he throws it to Seth Williams. Seth Williams, 6'3", plays much bigger than that.
And how about this one to Seth? Yeah. 233 yards, 3 touchdowns, 6 catches, 112-2. Auburn wins. Gus Boss a little mellowed out.
I thought he performed very well. He made some great throws under duress. I think our offense has great potential. You know, a little bit. Rusty at times, but I think there's great potential with that group. Our guys played 60 minutes. They fought. We had some adversity, a lot of ups and downs, but our guys made the plays to win the game. That's a good football team we beat.
All felt right on Saturday with the SEC returning. So many headlines that we could discuss with this conference. Joey, what is your headline from the first Saturday in the SEC?
Georgia's sitting at number 4, and year out, we talk about who can challenge Georgia for the SEC East. Jamie Newman opted out at quarterback. JT Daniel not cleared because of a knee injury. Stetson Bennett gets the start. And so we didn't think it would be pretty, but we didn't think it'd be 7-5 at halftime. Georgia doesn't scare anybody right now. And so when you look around the SEC East and wonder, can somebody topple Georgia? Florida made a huge statement today with their offense, the way Trask played. Tennessee is a team that has recruited well over the years, and we've just been waiting. When are they going to look like that team? They found a way to win, but it wasn't pretty either. So when you look at the SEC East, this thing is wide open. It'll be interesting to see if Florida can continue, because we've seen this before out of them, where Trask is really good, offense looks really good, and then they'll have a clunker like maybe against South Carolina last season. Mm-hmm. So if they can be consistent and play the way they did, Florida will have a chance to be the favorite to win the SEC.
You know, and after watching Georgia and Florida today, I would say right now, after the first game, I would say Florida's the team to beat in the SEC East, and it's because of that offense. Really, it's different. There was a lot of hype surrounding Florida coming into this season, right? Yeah. Because of the talent and because of the schedule. People are saying this could be a team that reaches the college football playoff, but what I know is this. For the first time since Tim Tebow in 2009, Florida has a difference maker and a game changer at quarterback in Kyle Trask. poise, accuracy, decision-making. You heard Dan Mullen say it. Gets them in the right plays, gets them in the right protections, in the run checks. The whole playbook is open at Dan Mullen's disposal because of the way Kyle Trask is going to play this year. And he's got an arsenal of weapons to throw to. It's not just Pitts at tight end. Kadarius Toney, Trevon Grimes, Jacob Copeland. They've got a lot of guys at receiver with speed that can win one-on-ones. They're going to score a lot of points. And you look at that schedule at Texas A&M after how they looked against Vanderbilt, winnable. LSU at home after how they looked against Mississippi State, winnable. And then Georgia in the neutral site. That's the big one. Georgia's won three in a row. But because of this offense and Kyle Trask, I think Florida should be the favorite right now in the East, maybe reaching the college football
playoff. Based on what we saw with Georgia Saturday, they went with the redshirt freshman to start the game. Stetson Bennett came in relief. They've got quarterback issues, and until someone can step up for them, I would agree with you. Florida, at least in week one, looks like the best team in that division. What about the ACC, Florida State, and Miami? May remember Mike Norvell tested positive for COVID-19. Chris Thompson had to step in. It's easy to step in when De'Aaron King's your quarterback.
And when you got Brevin Jordan, one of the best tight ends in the country, his involvement in this offense has gone up in the last two games.
Yeah, not an easy step in for Thompson when you're facing De'Aaron King. Second quarter, Joshua Corbin flips to Jordan Travis. They try to revert.
That is so Florida State. That's all that is. That's just what we've seen out of Florida State.
Guys, this is not the game that we've become accustomed to. This was absolutely embarrassing for the
De'Aaron King goes deep to D. Wiggins here. How about Miami's defense, guys? 13 tackles for loss, 6 sacks. They get their 4th straight win against the
Noles. They get Clemson next also.
And the Seminoles. I don't know why I just dropped the Tar Heels. This is Tallahassee, whatever. Seminoles. Beat
Mac appreciates
Miami.
It.
Mac does appreciate a little North Carolina slip in there. Louisville taking on Pittsburgh. Malik Cunningham, 2-2 Atwell, wide open for the touchdown.
Louisville, 17 unanswered points after being down 13. And they're going to need every bit of this.
Later in the second, 4th and 5, Kenny Pickett to Taysier Mack picks up the first down.
He's down.
Yeah, he is.
He's
he looks down. It, right?
No, he's not.
Oh, you got to.
No, he's doing his best Michael Dyer impersonation.
Oh, well
remember
done.
Him at Auburn?
Yeah.
National title game against Oregon. Never touches the ground. Elbow not down, butt not down, knee not down. Louisville's defense just takes a break. Knees off the ground. That's a TD.
Defensive coordinators are going to go nuts. Pitt takes a 20-17 lead. 4th quarter, Louisville down 23-20. Cunningham, pass over the middle, picked off by DeMar Hamlin.
Cunningham was 9 of 21, 107 yards, through 3 interceptions. This Pitt defense has played well this season.
By the way, I'm all in on this Pitt defensive celebration where they get to go to the sidelines and they get another dunk. They should. There it is.
Oh.
Get on, finish it. Pitt wins. Oh, Pittsburgh, Pat Narduzzi, 3-0, 2-0 in the division, in the conference, 23-20 Pitt. Hey, you guys know what's coming up? MVP Monday. A look back at 2 MVPs now in the NFL. Coming up next on College Football Final. And Chuba Hubbard, Big 12. Could they be the next best team to step up? Could they get West Virginia? And Baylor finally gets to play a little football. Before they were NFL MVPs, boy, were Mahomes and Lamar so good in college. Quickly, prediction Monday night.
I'm going to go with Mahomes. I think he's the best in the game.
And I like the Ravens. I just like the way they played the game.
You guys want to go back and look at these guys play some college
ball? Let's go back.
Let's go back to Mahomes 2016 against Oklahoma, Jesse.
Yeah, so I remember calling this guy's first game ever. Came off the bench at Oklahoma State, looked unsure of himself. And then I called his last game against LSU in a bowl game, slinging the pill from all different arm angles. This battle against Oklahoma and Baker Mayfield was epic and legendary. Andy Reid really smart to trade up and draft this guy. Now he's worth $500 million dollars and owns part of the Kansas City Royals.
By the way, our 2020 vision, you know how hindsight's always 2020, but these two, it legitimately was 2022 for 734 yards. What about Lamar against Florida State 2016?
Yeah, remember this is the game everyone's waiting to see because Florida State had a pretty good defense. Lamar Jackson, everyone's saying, hadn't played anybody, so let's see him against this athletic defense. He just ran for 146 and 4 touchdowns and threw for 216 and a touchdown. And this was the game that made him must-see TV. Anytime Louisville was playing, you sat back and watched Lamar Jackson.
Are we picking on Florida State a lot this show? Are we just highlighting Lamar being
just the it's about Lamar. It's about Lamar.
Okay, good, because these are some of the quarterbacks that may follow in the footsteps of Mahomes and Jackson. According to Todd McShay, Trevor Lawrence, Justin Fields are the top two quarterbacks in the 2021 NFL draft rankings, both projected to be top 10 picks. Rounding out his top five, Trey Lance, North Dakota, Texas A&M's Kellen Mond will agree to disagree there, and Iowa State's Brock Purdy. Speaking of Texas A&M and Kellen Mond, taking on Vanderbilt. Gentlemen, this isn't going to win a beauty contest. But Anais Smith.
Jimbo Fisher, very smart. Anais Smith was a receiver. Jimbo switched him into a running back to get more speed to the outside. Nice play there.
7-3, and then Mond to Caleb Chapman runs it into the end zone.
Alabama has Texas A&M has Alabama next. Mm. They didn't just hold back. They didn't want to show all their good stuff.
Oh, that's it?
No, they're holding some good stuff.
Okay,
back.
All right.
Well, Alabama.
Hey, a win is a win is a win. 17-12, they won. That's what counts, right?
Alabama.
Tennessee, could they be that team in the SEC East that maybe sneaks up? Jared Garantano's been there since the 90s. Eric Gray takes the handoff.
They're going to be expected to be able to run the ball week in, week out. One of the best offensive lines in the SEC, and Eric Gray is explosive.
21-7 Vols. Now, fourth quarter, game tied at 24. Garantano, Josh Palmer, no relation.
Garantano, 259 yards passing, one touchdown. If Tennessee has a chance, Garantano's going to have a big year.
All right, so Tennessee punting the ball away. South Carolina gets their stop. They have an opportunity to take the ball down and win the game. Paxton Brooks, the punt. Oh, no. Who's not yelling Peter? Someone didn't.
It's good football knowledge by you.
Thank you. Got to yell Peter.
That's
Peter.
All he knows.
Tennessee gets the win 31 to 27. All I know is that guy went to the Village Idiot later that night and
got
probably
weird.
Drank an adult beverage and got real weird. Speaking of getting weird, no one's lived more dangerously than them Raging Cajuns after that week one upset. Find out if the Billy Napier magic continues. Speaking of magic, Tulane, 66-24 on Saturday, setting the series record for points and shattering its previous record for margin of victory at 28. Southern Miss, perhaps helmet sticker implications on the way. Oh, you know what time it is?
Sunbelt Fun Belt.
So much fun. Louisiana hosting Georgia Southern. Fourth quarter, 3 minutes left of the game. Georgia Southern down 17-10. Shy Wirtz, play action to Bo Johnson.
Really a nice pass. Perfect location. There goes Bo Johnson down the sideline, rumbling, stiff-arming. Tries to extend the ball towards the pylon, and a man just loses control of it. That would be a touchback. Two turnovers for Georgia Southern in this game.
All right, so Georgia Southern gets one more opportunity. 1 minute left to play in the game. Same score, still down. Wirtz deep to Caleb Hood.
Caleb Hood is 5'10", 170, Matt. He's about your size. About time somebody represented for the smaller speed receiver.
Whoa, did you just say Matt's 5'10"?
I am sure 5'10".
For sure 5'10". Yeah, that's
5'10", 160.
That's generous.
Easy on the 170.
Generous.
For sure 5'10". I've done this before on TV with the height call. All right, two-point conversion. Darian Anderson gets the two-point conversion.
Yeah.
Look at
Wirtz right here. Actually uses the football to keep his balance, stay on his feet. Then he gets his eyes back downfield. Georgia Southern takes the lead, 18-17, only 54 seconds to go.
All right, so Louisiana, 20 seconds left, 3rd-and-13. Levi Lewis gets the ball to Trey Regas, picks up 18 yards to get them in field goal range. Would we have a college kicker scenario? 53 yards, Nate Snyder off the hash.
Easy.
Oh, my.
Go get him.
Just stepped up to that tee box and piped it right down the fairway. Nate Snyder, you're the hero.
Go out there and prove my team that I'm here for a reason. And, you know, just kind of make it up to them because I missed a couple kicks this season that I should have missed. So I knew, you know, I go out there and make the kick. I just have to have some confidence out there. So, you know, all the guys on the team coming up to me before the kick telling me, you know, you got this, man. You've done it in practice 100 times. Like, that helped pick me up.
All right. Look at that guy. Shoulder pads everywhere. Hero. Love when kicks the hero. Desmond Ritter in Cincinnati. Hosting Army. Army, rather. Desmond Ridder to Jayshon Jackson. Huge first down.
And it wasn't pretty early. I mean, Ridder missed some wide open receivers. Defense was playing well, holding Army to 7 points that are still in it.
Army had started the season so well, so physical. Here, Ridder to Michael Young.
Well, it was the defense that really won the game for Cincinnati. They held Army to only 4 yards of carry with that triple option, and Ridder did make some big throws in big moments.
And what did we say about that Jared Doakes kid a couple weeks ago? Find him. He's good.
He's going to score a touchdown every week. He makes final every week.
Cincinnati, 24-10 to remain undefeated, beating Army. UCF, East Carolina, Dylan Gabriel off to a good start to this season. Here finding Jalen Robinson. I mean, this guy's wide open.
The NASCAR tempo for UCF. They go so fast. They've got so much speed on offense. And Dylan Gabriel, back-to-back games with over 400 yards passing and 4 TDs.
Heisman talk too early or not enough?
No, get him in. Why not?
Okay, right.
Why too early?
We can do that.
5 games this season.
And we can do that.
Gabriel. 600 yards of total offense.
480 yards, 4 TDs. UCF beat down 51-28. Keeping our eye on this one, West Virginia, Neil Brown, it looks good early on. Oklahoma State had struggled quarterback issues. Hand the ball to L.D. Brown. He'll fix it.
Here's something crazy. I think through 2 games, L.D. Brown has been the best running back the Pokes have had. I think he's been better than Chuba.
It has not been Chuba's show. You're right. Oklahoma State up 7-0 based on what we saw a year ago. 3rd and 15, West Virginia. Jared Daigie strip sack. Trace Ford. Tyron Irby. Come on, big fella.
And what's been better than the offense at Oklahoma State? The defense. They might be the best defense in the Big 12 right now. Jim Knowles has his team playing.
You said Oklahoma State defense?
Oklahoma State defense.
The defense, Oklahoma State. Got it. Chuba, take it.
Over 200 yards rushing for the Pokes, and Shane Illingworth, the true freshman who came off the bench in relief in that win against Tulsa, showing really good poise keeping this offense on schedule.
So Oklahoma State finished 203 rushing yards as a team. They win 27-13. The Hat taking on Baylor. Baylor finally gets to play a football game with Dave Aranda, their new head coach. Big day for Tristan Ebner. Baylor up 24-7. Ebner, goal line, breaks a couple of tackles, gone.
This is a huge way to start a game. Matt Rhule left, and it's like nobody's talking about this Baylor football team. They just came out, got a game under their belt. That might be another team we look at in the Big 12.
That's how you come out of the half. That started the third quarter, fourth quarter after a safety. It's Ebner again, and again, he's gone.
Well, I think Dave Aranda is preaching the right things to do to win games, right? You got to play good defense. They didn't turn the football over, and you're going to have to make plays on special teams. How about Ebner? 2 kick return scores. Dave Aranda gets his first win as Baylor's coach.
47-14 the final. There were so many good plays on Saturday. Catches, receivers, quarterbacks, the stars. Plus, plenty of reasons to fine each other in studio for that's a dollar. But who earned the fine on the field? Find out next. A cash bag. That's a dollar. Also probably a violation. State starting quarterback Hendon Hooker was among 23 Virginia Tech players out due to positive COVID-19 test and contact tracing. They put a squad together with Bailey Hockman, drops back, picked off by Divine Diablo.
Phenomenal diving catcher. And how about Virginia Tech without legendary D coordinator Bud Foster on the sidelines? It seems like forever coming up with 2 takeaways.
I can't believe without all these players, they were able to piece together a roster to actually win big, Joe.
Yeah, and ran the ball for over 300 yards in this game and 3 touchdowns. If you can run it, doesn't matter who's out.
More ACC, Georgia Tech and Syracuse in that brand new Carrier Dome.
Ooh.
It's good. Named after Willis Carrier, inventor of modern air conditioning. Thank you, Willis. Sean Tucker runs up the middle, taken down by Wanye Thomas.
Yeah, you got another Michael Dyer situation here. Tucker doing a nice job. Defense just kind of gives up. Again, no elbow, no knee, no butt on the ground. He's up. And he's off to the races, and Syracuse needs something good to happen.
Syracuse has to have something. Jeff Sims throws a picture to Hyde Carter. Carter takes off, dodges some tackles before he wrapped up and pitching the ball to Trill Williams. I don't know what that was, but it was kind of fun to watch.
It's a great play when you're feeling good. Syracuse had 16 points through their first 2 games. They get 37 in this game. Finally, Dino Babers and his Syracuse offense is starting to look like what we expected.
Can we agree this was ill-advised 7 days?
No. This was advised.
What are you talking about?
This is like scoop and score. You think
no,
score.
It's not.
You don't get me a chance to score on defense.
Not new when, dome?
Not
hey, you want to be like Ed Reed?
Pitch it, go score.
Okay, fine.
Think big.
You're right. Syracuse goes on to win.
Dare to be great.
Dare to be great. Syracuse was on Saturday, 37-20 the final. All right, this is where the Dare to Be Great lands. Top plays, number 5, Duke, Virginia. Lavelle Davis finds Brennan Armstrong, who goes over the defender to make the catch.
Great job high-pointing the football over top of the Duke corner. Duke losing their 2 starting corners due to injury. Virginia took advantage, and they win 38-20.
All right, so Arkansas still trying trick plays. Traylon Burks has his pass intercepted by Richard LeCount.
Arkansas needs something to go right for him.
No.
And that's just not it.
It's not it.
You have to go a little further.
LeCount's the reason this is in there.
I don't think he had to catch with one hand. I think he just wanted to show off.
That's probably true. Yeah,
nothing wrong with
Texas
that.
Texas State, Boston College, Brady McBride, our guy.
Brady McBride.
Marcel Barbie.
I feel like Marcel Barbie has made top plays like 2 or 3 weeks in a row by now. Keep making one-handed catches like this, we'll keep seeing you on top plays.
You know what they say, it's a Barbie world.
That's the second time you've done that, so that's another dollar.
Number 2, Liberty, Florida International. DJ Stubbs to Malik Willis laying out for the touchdown.
Looks like another 5'10 receiver here, Matt Barry. I see you going to find the smaller receivers for us this
Look
time.
Look, come on,
somebody got to represent.
Look, 5'10. Hardly a speck of athletic ability, but you got more heart to take down. That's Rudy. Georgia Southern, Caleb Hood, Shy Wirtz.
My guy. It's my guy.
So good. So good. You know what? We got a new segment this year on College Football Final. It's called That's a Dollar. We fine each other a dollar for saying or doing stupid things. Some would say it's a Barbie world.
That's a dollar. That's a dollar.
That is a dollar.
Did he tip the guy?
Not a dime.
That online. Is a...
I tipped online.
Snubbed him
dollars.
Twice.
Still getting a dollar.
A Charlotte player attempted to do the worm.
That's 10 dimes. You're the punter. You got one job. Come on, man. That's a dollar.
That's a
dollar.
It's a terrible camera angle.
Whoa. Is it game?
Right here.
We're playing.
Did I miss class?
Actually, there was a kick, but TV was not ready.
That's a dollar. We are passing out fines quicker than you can imagine. This week's That's a Dollar.
Let's go.
We're going to start with Army. And Joey, this is ill-advised every day of the week.
When are people going to learn headbutting is not good? They took it out of the UFC for... You didn't even headbutt a UFC anymore. He almost killed this guy.
I don't think he actually thought his player was going to do that to him.
Yeah.
All right, mask up. Mask
okay
up.
With it,
it's a pandemic.
That's a dollar for him thinking that was cool. UCF, they could score points, right?
Yeah.
In the first quarter alone, UCF had 7 false starts.
Crowd noise.
In the first quarter?
Was it a lot of crowd noise?
7. They should be fined a dollar every one of those 7.
It's not going to save you a dollar.
No, it's a dollar. UCF, come on. 7 false starts, dollar. You're lucky you don't get 7 of them.
All right, look, I don't care how old you are. I don't care what grade you're in. We don't discriminate here on That's a Dollar. Opposing team, Kylan Hill, scores. Look at my man in the end zone. Hi. That's a dollar. This is Death Valley. This is supposed to be a hostile environment. Look at my girl over here jumping up and down, applauding. Hey, you two, go sell some lemonade, bring back 50 cents each, and pay your dollar. I don't care.
You can't pick on, you know what? You're right. It's Death Valley.
Listen, it's Death
You're
Valley.
You're national champions.
Okay, 8 years old.
They got to learn.
Act like you've been, I know there's not tailgating.
People were using 4-letter words and screaming at me when I played at Death Valley.
Things have changed, Jess. Don't you know that? Oh, coveted helmet stickers. We gave out some bonus ones. Who gets the end of show sticker, the most coveted gift in all of college football? Start your Sunday every Sunday. Sunday NFL Countdown, 10 a.m. Eastern, ESPN and the ESPN app. We had BYU After Dark. BYU and Troy, 10:15 Eastern was the kick. Zach Wilson, Dax Milne, 70-yard touchdown. BYU in a rout.
BYU, 664 yards in this game. It was late, but the offense was awake.
Doesn't matter. They won big late. We love late. We did 4 halftimes this Saturday, and every single one of them was special. And now the best part of the program, coveted helmet sticker time. There was so much good football on Saturday. We gave 3 in the A block. Now we're going to wrap up with the traditional helmet sticker ceremony. Who do you have, Joey?
I'm going Kyle Trask, 416 yards passing, 6 touchdowns in the SEC opener. You know who was the last person to do that? Jesse Palmer?
Jesse Palmer?
Joe Burrow.
Oh, come on. Good tease. Gotcha.
That was a good tease. Come on, Palmer. How about Seth Williams, guys? Wide receiver, Auburn. 112 yards, two touchdowns in their win against Kentucky. I'll tell you what, great catch radius. You put it near the guy, seems to come down with it. And Bo Nix being in his second year, good receiving group. Chad Morris, the new offensive coordinator. I think this is the best passing game we've seen from Auburn in a couple years.
Let's give some love to my guy, Cameron Carroll, Tulane. That offense was brilliant. Carroll was brilliant. 163 rushing yards, three touchdowns, one receiving touchdown. By the way, first Tulane player over the last season with three straight games. Multiple rush TDs. Cameron Carroll, get it. Why do you have one helmet?
I'm going back to Florida. Probably the first time. I don't know if this has ever been done. Two guys on one team. Kyle Pitts was just too good. Eight catches, 170 yards, four touchdowns. The last guy to do that at Florida, Isaac Jason Hilliard, better known as Ike.
Ike, who I played with the Giants. Someone's really happy they didn't have to go and get Joey another helmet, by the way, so you're helping out the production assistants.
Yeah.
Richard LeCount, safety for Georgia, had two picks for them in their win, and it's big because with Georgia right now having to figure out that quarterback situation, offense a little bit slow, defense is going to have to hold their weight for a little while. Richard LeCount's a leader on that team.
Iowa State bounces back. They get a win against TCU. Breece Hall, the reason why. 154 yards rushing, three touchdowns. Second Iowa State player over the last 25 seasons with 150 rushing touchdowns, three rushing touchdowns, 150 rushing yards, and three touchdowns in a game. Joe Lannon, the other. There's our helmet stickers. Next week, you don't get to do this.
Well, and they have a big game, I mean.
Yeah, that's true.
I got Ike Hilliard in the show. That's what I'm excited about.
Isaac James, is that what it was?
Isaac Jason Hilliard.
Goodbye, Joseph, Jesse, and Matt.